Hello, I'm Philip Ardagh, and I'm here at the invitation of Orion Books to speak to children's author Cliff McNish. Hello, Cliff.
Hello.
Perhaps we could start at the beginning. Have you always wanted or needed to write?
Not really at all, no. I left school really without any particular interest in English. I used to read stories and I suppose occasionally, but I wasn't even that much of a reader when I was at school. And I didn't really think about writing until I reached the age of 37. And
then heavens, that's quite an age, because we know lots of children who are, I'm sure, emailing you or writing to you or asking you at workshops, saying, how do I get to write? But it wasn't until you were quite aged old boot that you really got the bug.
Aged old boot, exactly. That's exactly what I was. And it was really because my daughter, Rachel, was separated from me. She lived with her mother, and she had done since she was about a year and a half old. Mm-hmm. And I was just looking for a way of staying in contact with her, really, between normal visits. And I wasn't seeing enough of her, really. So I'd always told her stories, typical dad, you know, just telling his daughter stories. And I asked her on this case what she wanted a story about. I thought, I'll write her a little story. And her answer to that question really was what changed my life, because she said, I still remember what she said. She said, Dad, I want a story about a really, 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 really nasty witch.
A nasty witch. Well, that's fantastic. And she was how old about this?
She was about 9 at the time.
About 9 years old. And did you... So you thought you'd go away and write it, or did you start by just telling it, tell a story?
No, I didn't know what to do with this. I mean, I asked her what she wanted in the story, apart from the witch, and she kind of listed these things off. She wanted her best friend Sandra and a dragon and loads of magic and spells. And not surprisingly, she said, oh, and I want to be the main character in the story with the most magic. So she kind of gave me these elements. But, you know, I hadn't written a story since I was a kid. I didn't know what to do with it. And eventually, actually, I promised her this story and I hadn't started it. And I kind of panicked and thought, I've got to do something.
It's all these elements for what to do.
Yeah, and I just started writing with this image of this woman walking down a staircase. And it just got bigger and bigger. And 6 or 7 months later, I'd written this sort of mini Lord of the Rings epic.
So how long was this epic at this stage?
It was probably about 500 or 600 pages long.
Now, that's a lot, isn't it? If anyone can imagine that, that would be a very fat book. I think Lord of the Rings is a great comparison. So was she reading it as you were going? Were you sending her chapters, or were you reading it to her, or how did it...
I wasn't reading it to her. I asked her what she wanted at different places. And she insisted on these dragons, which I didn't want in the story. Everybody wants dragons. And then I finished it and I gave it to her. And, of course, she's the main character in the story. Mm-hmm. She's got the most magic. She gets to battle the witch. So, and the description of Rachel physically as well exactly matched my real Rachel as much as I could. So, not surprisingly, she was fairly keen on it.
Right. So what became, because, of course, we now know with hindsight that manuscript in some form became Doomspell, your first book. Now, the central character is Dragweena, and is this terrifying witch. Yeah. And she's bald and she's got a pitted skull. I think she has four jaws. Mm-hmm. Was she a fully formed? Could you see her in your head before you wrote it? Or was it the process of writing that
it was the process of writing. I mean, something that I bring across to kids quite a lot is that, you know, your first idea for a horrible character is nearly always the same as everybody else's. And I saw her as just this woman with large eyes, but very pretty. It's only gradually that I realised not only should she be psychologically dark, but physically she should be so as well.
Names, I think, I mean, Dragweena is a wonderful example, but I think even in your other books later on, in your other series, names are important to you?
I would say not really. I mean, I do like to come up with a character that I think, oh, yeah, that's a good name. For instance, the witch name Hebra. Mm-hmm. As soon as I thought of that, I liked it. Galtrathica. Most people can't pronounce it, but I like that name. But a lot of the time, names in my books are just anagrams or playings with letters of people's names.